Hello everyone! Do you know how much energy you use? In the remainder of this week, we will introduce you to tools where you can calculate your own energy consumption. So I'm using the term energy consumption, but is that really correct? The law of energy conservation tells us that energy can only be converted from one form to another, but the energy is not exactly consumed. So energy use would be a more appropriate term. In the coming blocks, we will look at energy use in transportation, in buildings, and in industry. First, we will look at the energy use in transportation. There are several modes of transportation powered by different energy sources. The energy conversion process that powers a steam railway engine is different from an electric-powered car. The coal-fired steam railway engine is slowly becoming obsolete. However, it has been one of the most important modes of large-scale transportation since the turn of the 20th century. The chemical energy contained in coal is the primary fuel used to power these engines. The coal is fed into a furnace where the chemical energy of the fuel heats up water to form steam. The hot steam drives the pistons, thus converting the thermal energy into mechanical energy. The pistons move the wheels and impart motion to the engine. The automobile, or the passenger car, has a different sort of engine. It runs on the chemical energy contained in gasoline or diesel. The fuel is combusted under pressure and the energy released from the combustion is used to drive the pistons. The mechanical energy in the pistons turns the axle and the wheels, imparting motion to the car. An electric car works somewhat differently. Electrical energy from your plug point is used to charge the battery of the car. The stored electrical energy is then fed into an electric motor. In turn, the electric motor converts the electrical energy into mechanical energy in the form of motion. A bicycle uses a different fuel, an engine, to create motion. The chemical energy stored in food is converted by our body, which is the engine, into mechanical energy, which we use to turn the pedals. The pedals and the gears turn the wheel and impart motion to the bicycle. How much energy is used by these different modes of transportation? What is the energy used for and where is it lost? To be able to compare the energy use required for transportation, it is important to be able to calculate what the energy from the fuel is used for. Let us try and calculate the energy use of a passenger car. The energy contained in the gasoline or diesel is used to power the car. During a typical journey between two points, a car has to overcome several forces. Any moving object has to overcome air resistance, which always acts against the direction of motion. The power required to overcome air resistance is expressed as Pa. Mathematically, Pa is equal to half times the C drag times A times rho times V to the power 3. Cd is known as the drag coefficient and is a dimensionless quantity. A stands for the effective area, which is the cross-section area of the front of the car that faces the oncoming air during its motion. Rho pertains to the density of air, and V is the speed at which the car is moving. The air resistance is proportional to the third power of the velocity V, meaning that the air resistance increases significantly if a car is traveling faster. It is relatively simple to arrive at this equation. Let's break it down. At the front side of the car, air is pushed aside as the car is moving. At the back side, air is being sucked in, otherwise a vacuum would be formed. This means that at the back side of the car, the air has the same velocity as the car itself. So the volume of air per unit time is A times the velocity V, which is being placed. If you multiply this by the density of air rho, you get the total air mass per unit time. The kinetic energy per unit of time is half times the air mass times the velocity squared. Substituting the equation for the air mass per unit of time leads to the final form of this equation, which is half times A times rho times V cubed. From the formula, you can see that a lower A cross-section would result in a lower air resistance. This is why racing cars are lower and have a smaller cross-sectional area, making them more aerodynamic. The car also has to overcome friction between the road and its tires. This is known as the rolling resistance. The power PR required to overcome the rolling resistance is given by CR multiplied by MG and velocity V. CR is called the rolling coefficient, M is the mass of the car, G is the gravitational acceleration, and V is again the velocity. Naturally, larger, heavier cars will face a larger rolling resistance. The kinetic energy of a moving car is absorbed by the brakes when they are used to bring the car to a halt. This is known as braking power, or PB. The kinetic energy is expressed as half times the mass times the velocity squared. This is lost when the car comes to a halt. The time between two braking events can be defined as the distance traveled between the two braking events divided by the velocity. Now the equation for the braking power PB becomes the kinetic energy divided by the time between two braking events. Rearranging the terms in this equation gives us the final definition for the braking power, which is half times the mass of the car times V to the power 3 divided by the distance traveled at speed V before braking. Thus, the rough estimation of the total power that a car engine needs to move between two points is the sum of the power required to overcome air resistance, rolling resistance, and power required for braking. Let us now take a look at how each of these terms vary depending on the driving conditions and the car by plugging some realistic numbers into these equations. Let the mass M of the car be something like 1000 kilograms. The effective front area A of the car is 1.5 square meters. Let the speed at which the car is traveling be 20 meters per second. Note that 20 meters per second equals 72 kilometers per hour. The distance D which the car travels before coming to a halt at a traffic light is, let's say, 1000 meters. Typical values for the drag coefficient CD and the coefficient of rolling resistance CR are 0.3 and 0.01, respectively. The air resistance and the gravitational acceleration have standard values of 1.3 kilograms per cubic meters and 9.8 meters per second squared. Using these values, we get 2.16 kilowatts of air resistance, 1.9 kilowatts of rolling resistance, and 4 kilowatts of braking resistance. You can see that the power required to overcome braking resistance is larger than the other two, while the rolling resistance is the lowest. This is largely because of the speed at which the car is moving. At higher speeds, the air resistance and the braking resistance, which are proportional to the third power of the speed, dominate over the rolling resistance. If you have ever tried to push a stalled car, you experience this yourself. It requires a lot of energy to get the car moving, but once it's in motion, you can keep it moving even if you push it with just one hand. Let us now reduce the speed of this car to 10 meters per second. The first thing we see is that all the three resistances are much lower than the previous case. At 10 meters per second, the rolling resistance is now the dominant force, while the air resistance and the braking power is lower. This means that the slower you drive, the less force is required to overcome air resistance and the easier it is to brake. Thus, if you drive slower, you will lose less fuel to braking and air resistance, but it will take longer for you to reach your destination. Is there a way to travel faster and still reduce braking resistance? Let us put the speed of the car back to the 20 meters per second as we used before. Let us now change the distance which the car travels before braking. Instead of stopping after 1,000 meters, let us make it stop after 15,000 meters. What happens to the braking resistance now? As you can see, the braking resistance has reduced from 4 kilowatts to just 0.26 kilowatts and is now the least of the three opposing forces. This is why you get a higher mileage out of your car when you drive on the highway compared to when you are driving in the city where you have to brake frequently. Modern cars these days have regenerative braking, where a large portion of the kinetic energy that is absorbed by the brakes is recovered, reducing the braking resistance considerably. Apart from the energy required to overcome these three forces that oppose motion, energy is also used within the car. A typical internal combustion engine has an efficiency of about 25%, which means that to overcome the power of resistance of 10 kilowatts, 40 kilowatts of chemical power in the form of fuel is consumed. In addition, there is a certain amount of power utilized to start a car from a standing position, as well as energy that is consumed by the car climate control and other features. The chemical energy needed to travel 100 km by car ranges from 40 kilowatt hours up to 120 kilowatt hours, depending on the type of car and the typical driving conditions. This table gives a comparison of the energy spent per passenger for every kilometer traveled using different modes of transportation. Public transport vehicles, such as buses, trains, and trams, are built so that the effective frontal area is not much larger than a passenger car, but can fit many more people. As a result, the energy required for overcoming air resistance is slightly larger than a passenger car, but distributed among a greater number of people. This makes public transport a much more efficient mode of transportation compared to passenger cars. If we take a look at the distribution of passenger car use around the world, we see a large difference. This table shows the number of vehicles per 1,000 people. Countries such as India, China, and Brazil have significantly smaller vehicular use compared to the US, the Netherlands, or the UK. It should be noted that the population of India, China, and Brazil is much larger, and an increase in the number of vehicles used to even half of those used in the US or the UK would increase the energy spent on transportation enormously. Next to transportation by means of vehicles, we transport people and goods by ships over water and planes through the sky. We will discuss these types of transportation methods and their corresponding energy use in detail using exercises after this video lecture. If we look at energy use on a global level, we estimate that the transportation is responsible for around 25% of our energy use. In the next video, we will discuss how much energy we use in buildings and homes.